Here's what's coming up on Anthrocon Online. Uncle Kage's Story Hour. And after that, Rhubarb and Cosmic Live.
Hi there, everyone. I hope that you're enjoying this virtual version of Anthrocon being brought to you from the magnificent city of Pittsburgh. As was described earlier, the whole point of this was to give you the Anthrocon experience with Pittsburgh being part of it. Because what is Anthrocon without Pittsburgh? When the crew asked me where I wanted Uncle Kage's Story Hour to be filmed, the first place I thought of was right here, Pizza Parma. Furryland Cafe, if you will, the place that has been Fernando's to us since time immemorial. So here indeed we have Uncle Kage's Story Hour, which is basically me standing here for an entire hour just making lots of noise. And this is a functioning restaurant, so people are gonna come in and get their food. That's quite all right, because Barris, the owner, he's gonna make a lasagna wrap for me when we're done. Anyway, the entire point of this being virtual is because we are still kind of stuck in that whole COVID thing. It's not quite finished yet. But all of us by now have gotten accustomed to conducting business, conducting life, if you will, online. I recently had a interesting little development because I, even as a scientist, I can do part of my work from home. And I was on a Zoom call with someone, one of these administrative calls where they want to do a bunch of stuff that business people think is interesting and all the scientists just say, yeah, right. I have a pro tip for everybody out there. If for your job you are doing any kind of Zoom call, any kind of broadcast, even a presentation, and you want to include a video, do not go straight to a live YouTube video. Remember that. Do not try to use a YouTube video in your presentation. Why? Because all of those suggested videos on the right side, they are taken from your YouTube history. And YouTube figures you might want to see these. I did not want to draw attention to it when this very, very nice lady was showing us this, I don't know, something about business this and that and EBITDAs and things. And all along the side were these pictures of these beefy boys in thongs. But anyway, that's a pro tip for you. The problem, too, that I've had with this whole COVID thing and lockdown is that I really haven't had time or opportunity to really get any new stories because you're stuck at home. I'm not traveling around. You know, I trip over something. That really doesn't make for a good story. I did get one, though. One single story comes out of this for me. I have some very good friends. I've told stories about them before. They've got two wonderful growing boys. The oldest son, Adam, he was, I guess, about 5 years old. This was a couple of years ago. I'm very, very close to the family, and the boys call me Uncle Sam. You know, I'm like that guy that comes over that the parents say, call him uncle, even though he's not your uncle. But I was invited for dinner, and Adam was very, very reluctant to eat his vegetables. And they were trying to tell him, you know, no, you have to eat your vegetables, and he was stubborn. He did not want to eat these things. So old Uncle Sam decided that he was going to help raise the boy right. I said, say, Adam, did you ever notice how your old Uncle Sam, he's all like, you know, this and blah, 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 and how your dad is all fit and stalwart and stuff? The reason for that is because I never ate my vegetables when I was young. Your dad always ate his vegetables. And Adam pondered this for a moment and then burst into tears, just sobbing hysterically. And we were taken, well, okay, Adam, it's okay. You don't really have to eat the vegetables. And he said, but I don't want to look like him. So that's the setup. This is the five-year-old who managed to riff me. My friends, unfortunately, caught it. The horrible COVID struck their household. Fortunately, a mild case. Nobody was left with any lasting problems from this. But they, of course, were quarantined. So I made up a care package, primarily of a giant box of bottles of wine, because, well, I care. So what I did was I brought this box and set it down on their doorstep and rang the bell. And when they came out, there was this box of bottles of wine with a soup can sitting on top, with a string attached to the soup can going clear out to the sidewalk where I was standing with another soup can. And we stretched the string taut and were able to communicate. I thought it was cute because Adam and his brother were absolutely fascinated by this newfound technology that I had just introduced them to. They were captivated by it. So once again, you know, Uncle Sam wants to raise the boys, right? I said, yeah, you know, this is what we used to use before we had cell phones. See, every kitchen would have a soup can in it, and there would be the string going out the window. And the strings would be all tied to these poles you see out here. And if you wanted to call a friend, you'd have to have him pick up the soup can in his kitchen. And Adam said, wow. And he looked at his mom and said, is that true? His mom said, oh, no, it's Uncle Sam. Of course it's not true. But I take exception to that. All my stories are true. But since I don't have too many new ones, I am forced to rely on some stories from ancient days, back before all the gray got into my hair. I realized when I was thinking about what to talk about that a particular story goes back 20 years. I've been doing this for that long and longer. I remember telling it on stage in Philadelphia. Very, very few people are still around who remember those famous days and years. But I was working for a company that had a business office outside of Paris, and it was decided that a bunch of the scientific staff was going to be flown out to France to have a meeting with all our colleagues in Paris. And I thought, okay, this, I had never actually been abroad before, so I was excited to go, got my passport and everything. I had studied French in high school and then further into college. I just never thought I'd had the opportunity to use it, and I was pretty sure it was all gone anyway. But they bundled us all together, put us onto a plane, shipped us over to Paris, and I was looking forward to not just the trip, but to meeting two people in particular. Number one, also attending this meeting, was going to be a colleague of mine from our Rotterdam office. He had the best name in the world, Pieter Kool. If you're gonna have a name, if you're gonna be a Dutchman and you need a name, call yourself Pieter Kool. I just loved it. I had only ever spoken to him on the phone. He sounded gruff and growly and grumbly, but I think that's just Dutch. And the other person was, because I'm a furry, I had met a French furry, had been talking to him on the internet, and I said, hey, dude, guess what? I'm going to be in freaking Paris. I know you live outside Paris. We should get together. So that plan was made. We arrived in Paris, and we were standing out at the corner with all our bags and everything, and the company had sent a large taxi van that fits, you know, 1,000 people or whatever. It fit everybody comfortably in the back. There was only one seat left up front with the driver, so I took that, the shotgun seat, as we call it. And the boss, whose name was Dick, very few men can live up to their name, by the way. Dick had said to us in that charming Boston accent of his, now I speak French, you all just stay quiet, let me do the talking. And I said, all right, whatever. So we got in, and Dick tapped the driver on the shoulder and said, Nouveau drones à l'air à la Hotel Mercure. And the driver looked a little pained and a little embarrassed. He glanced over at me, and I said, okay. Nous voudrons aller à l'hôtel Mercure, s'il vous plaît. Le patron, il est un peu ivrogne. Which is, you'll have to excuse my boss. He's a little drunk. We want to go to the Hotel Mercure. Now, fortunately, Dick's French was not that good. He didn't realize what I said. He said to me, Sam, I didn't know you spoke French. And I said, neither did I. We got to the hotel, and Dick's whole concept of, you know, getting the crew together, we are now in France, we're going to go out and all get pizza. because when in Paris, have pizza. I made some excuse because I had arranged to hop back on the train. I was going to meet that furry friend of mine in Paris. And it sounded simple. Meet me at Gare Montparnasse. Montparnasse is the main rail station in the middle of Paris. And it had not occurred to me until I arrived that saying, meet me at Gare Montparnasse is akin to saying, meet me in North America. Because Montparnasse starts here and just continues on forever. And these are the days before cell phones. I wasn't quite sure what to do. So I wandered around the station, and eventually I found a phone booth, and I called his home phone, which is what you had to do. He picked up the tin can with the string attached to it. No, that's not true. I got his answering machine. And I said, okay, I'm at Montparnasse, and I don't think I'm going to be able to find you. I have an idea. I'm at the Hotel Mercure. I'll hop back on the train. You can come out there. We'll get together there instead. So I went back to the Mercure, and I was sitting in their bar, a nice, pleasant little place, and enjoying some French wine, which, with apologies to my friends in France, your wine is not as good as the Germans. I'm sorry, that's true. And I'm saying that because I'm on camera right now and you can't hit me. I was watching the door and a fellow walked in, looking around. You know, you can tell when somebody comes in looking for somebody. And he saw me and I just sort of, he walked over and he said, American? I said, mm-hmm. He said, Conway. I said, yeah, oui, je suis le petit cafard que tu cherches. Which in French is, yes, I'm the little cockroach you're looking for. He said, oh, I'm Peter Kuhl from Rotterdam. I said, oh, really, Peter? I said, great to meet you. Do you speak French? He said, no. I said, good. Those of you who do not know, my fursona, if you will, is a cockroach. It's one of the few insects that I know of in the fandom. The people kind of cringe a little bit and say, cockroach. The problem is the name. You know, if you refer to them as snuggabugs, it makes them seem a lot less greasy. But that's an aside. I hung out with Peter for a while, and then eventually this furry must have gotten home and listened to his answering machine. I met up with him. We went back into Paris and took in all the parasites, went to a lovely little wine shop. And again, I was trying to pretend that this was the best wine I'd ever had. There's an old saying, I'd rather have a bottle in front of me than a frontal lobotomy. Even though this was not the best wine in the world, it was in front of me. And I've long maintained that my favorite wine is the one that's in front of me at any given time. So we went through a significant amount, let's just say. And I discovered that deeply buried in the back of my mind, all that French learning will return if one is drunk and lost in Montparnasse around midnight on a weekday in Paris. Because my friend escorted me back to the station, figuring I would be able to find my way to the train. Well, there was something I had to find first, because after all that wine, I sort of needed to find the little room where one can be alone, if you've ever read the Little Prince, that phrase. Well, I looked for the sign, and what I saw was a green sign that had a little silhouette of a man running. I said, that must be it. So I followed the sign and wound up on the street. Okay, maybe that's not the universal symbol. I went back in and found what was the universal symbol, the man and woman standing next to each other. Okay, great. There's the man, woman is pointing this way. So I walked down all the way to the end of the concourse, and there was the same sign pointing that way. Okay, so I turned all the way to the end of that concourse, and that same sign now pointing this way. And I was thinking, okay, Montparnasse is a square. I'm running out of corners here. We got to the far end of the concourse, and there was a long set of stairs, and the sign was pointing down. And I walked down the stairs to see a long, completely dark hallway that stretched nearly into infinity, except at the very, very distant end, there is a little pool of light. And I looked at this and I said, so this is how I die. Well, I kind of crept my way through the darkness, got to the end, and saw another sign that is very, very universal that you don't need to understand French. Hours, 10 a.m. to 10 p.m. It was now after that time. So I went upstairs, and there was a tiny little coffee shop, and I was very hopeful that they would have their own restroom. So I went up to the man at the counter, and I said, Monsieur, je suis un barbare américain, and j'ai besoin de votre salle de bain maintenant. Which is, sir, I'm an American barbarian, and I need your bathroom right now, damn it. He said, oui, 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 oui. So fortunately, that pressure was alleviated. Then came the challenge of finding my train, because there are about 25,000 tracks in Montparnasse. And I managed to get at least in the right direction, the regional trains, and I couldn't figure out which was mine, and I found a station clerk who did not speak English, but neither did he speak French. We were able to, utilizing various forms of sign language, I told him I need to go to the, you know, Parle-Doux region. He said, there. I said, time. He said, okay, got it. I managed to get on the train and sat down, was watching the countryside go by. And the train driver must have known that he had a tourist who was having his first visit to France, because at one point there was a break in the trees, and framed in that break, lit up, was the Eiffel Tower. I had not actually gotten a chance to see it. And it just, my mind was blown, like, oh my gosh. It finally hit me. I am actually in France. There it is, the symbol of Paris itself, La Tour Eiffel. And the train driver obligingly slowed down and came to a very gentle stop so that the tower was perfectly framed in that break in the trees. And I'd wished I'd had a camera, because it was spectacular. It was breathtaking. I just kept staring at it and staring and staring and... After about 40 minutes, that tower was getting real damn old. It was very, very, very late at night when the train finally started moving again. I wasn't sure why. I told some French people about this, and they said, yeah, that's trains. And I also happened to notice, on the regional train, you always have a little map that shows the train's route, and it's got the station stops listed. Well, this one kind of had this where I wanted to go, but then there was a piece that went off like this, and there were no stations. It just like an empty line going up there. I thought, I'm not on, I mean, okay, is that the road to hell or something? And I looked around and I felt that everybody else on the train was looking at me. And I thought, these are cannibals. This is how I died. And when we got to that little spot where it was branching off, my heart was in my mouth. And when the train started moving again, I was kind of sitting like this, and about 5 minutes went by and we didn't hit another station. Fortunately, before I died of fright, we did. And I got all the way out to my destination, was exhausted. It was probably coming up on dawn by then. I hadn't had any sleep. I was still somewhat out of it, shall we say. And there was a taxi, and I got in. I was a little too exhausted even to try French. And I said, hi, American. Hotel Mercure, please. He looked over his shoulder and said, do you know the way? And I said, and I leaned up real close and I said, don't dick with me. He understood that well enough. My colleagues the next day couldn't really understand why I looked disheveled as though I hadn't slept. I told them that the bed was lumpy or something like that. But the one thing I wanted was some coffee. I mean, there's one thing the French know how to do is make coffee. If you're unaware of the process, the actual coffee process, the coffee beans are grown in tropical regions like South America. The beans are then packaged up in bulk, and they are sent to France and also to Germany. And in that area, the beans are roasted, ground up, and then the French make their coffee out of that, and then they spread the grounds out on these very, very large sheets in the middle of an open field under the sun to dry. And then they gather it all up, package it up, call it Maxwell House, and send it to the United States. If you've not had proper European coffee, you really are missing out. Well, the nice lady at the office who was responsible for making the coffee, I couldn't take my eyes off her because she had this beautiful pot of coffee. All the Americans were on this side of the table, all the French were on this side of the table. She came right up to me and put the coffee pot down, and I was ready to reach for it, and she said, "Oh," and grabbed the pot and ran off. And I said, "Wait, what's up? What's going on?" And I leaned back and I watched her go into a little kitchenette, pour half of the coffee out, and then refill it with water from the tap. My colleagues thought it was the best coffee they'd ever had. I myself was disappointed. It's odd. Furry fandom has flown me more places than my job ever has. My job pretty much keeps me stationary. There's not a lot of call for chemists to jet around the world, to get up on stage, put on a white coat, drink too much, which I'm not doing right now because it's actually morning. Bad planning on your part there, crew. But I still am able to get good stories of travel, places I've been, the things I've seen, like remote, wild, untamed places like Arkansas, where I spent 3 very long years of my life. In the early part of my career, in search of a job, I found myself down in the little tiny town of Jefferson, Arkansas, where there was a facility that was a U.S. Food and Drug Administration facility, but it hadn't always been. That facility was attached to Pine Bluff Arsenal, and it had at one time been the United States' primary biological warfare research facility. I bet you didn't think we had that sort of thing. Guess what? We did. I never was 100% sure if I should be telling this story, but so far nobody's come up with chloroform, so I'm just going to keep going till that happens. It was an ancient building, very, very governmental, very cinder blockish, and had really heavy doors. And over the door was a big box with a metal arm hanging out. This is the door, the actual door to my laboratory. And every time I would open the door, it would bump that arm. And I kept asking maintenance, "Can you fix that?" But they had other things to do. I was working one day in the fume hood, which is a big vacuum box that pulls all the fumes out. And I was working with ether. Ether is a very, very fun chemical, not only for the effects it can have if you get too much of it in your lungs, which is why I'm in that fume hood, but it burns very, very, very rapidly and very spectacularly. In fact, it is so flammable that even a static electric spark can cause it to ignite. I discovered that one day because I was working with a large amount of ether, and to this day, I still don't know exactly what caused it. The ether was in an Erlenmeyer flask, and it was boiling gently on a hot plate. And then all of a sudden, the entire hood turned into a wall of flame. And I jumped back. And at the other end of the laboratory was a large fire extinguisher about as tall as I was. I never could understand what this thing was in there for, with a big cone on it. And it had instructions on it that said, "Stay back 30 feet." Okay, great. The entire lab was about 20 feet across. And I was met at the door by my boss, who saw this happen, and he said to me, "Quick, shoot it." So I grabbed this huge cone, but when I turned around, remember I said ether tends to burn rapidly? Most of it had burned down, and there was just a little, like, candle flame going at the top of the flask. And I looked at it, and I looked at this massive, you know, death machine of an extinguisher. And the boss said, "Go on and shoot it." And I said, "Well, it's not sporting. It's, I mean, look at it. It's just a baby." He said, "God damn it, go ahead and shoot the thing." I said, "All right." So I lined up, and it went out on its own. That could have been the end of the story. But then all of a sudden, a loud siren started on the roof. And red lights started flashing all throughout the building. There was a small holdover from the early days. There was a heat sensor in the hood. And when this siren went off and those red lights started flashing, there was a grinding noise from that box above the door, and that rusty metal arm moved across. And it occurred to me that that was designed in the event of a fire or similar circumstance, that door was going to close and not open again. So think about that. I was very, very intrigued because that was the first I had ever realized, okay, this was like the Andromeda strain at one point. So I decided to go exploring. And Dwight told me, "You know, you can explore all you want, just do not go into any places that are sealed." And I said, "No problem, that's not a problem." You know, if a door has a big padlock on it, that's sealed. But if the padlock is on it, but I can actually pull the hasp out of the wall, that's not sealed. They're not really serious, but if they had meant that to be sealed, they would have had a stronger hasp. That was my argument. Because in one of the buildings, there was a big steel, huge door. It looked like a blast door in a wall. And outside, there was what looked like just maybe a 20 by 20 room. And I wanted to know what was in that room. Why would they need that big blast door? And it wasn't sealed. Well, with the help of a crowbar, it wasn't sealed. And I poked my nose in, and I saw that it was not a room. There was a set of stairs that went down and turned a corner. There was a light switch. I flipped it on, and old ancient bulbs that looked like they'd been there for 50 years and probably had came on. I looked around, nobody was looking. I stepped inside, made sure that door was not going to lock, and made my way down this long descending spiral staircase that just went down and down and down, down deep into the bowels of the earth. And when I reached the bottom, there was a, I guess, oval patch there, or hatch there, with a big steel hatch door on it, and the remains of a rubber gasket around it, and a big red button on the wall. You know what that's for. Something happens in there, you slam the door, push that big red button, and that gasket inflates and doesn't let anything out or anyone. I was really intrigued by that, so I stepped through and found myself in a little like phone booth size control room. And there was another light switch, and I flicked it on, and here too, I wish this had been in the days when everybody had a camera with it, because this little control booth had a glass window, and when that light came on, I just saw a room that went on literally to the vanishing point that had a long, long row of glove boxes in it. Glove boxes, you've seen scientists on TV, you got the box with the gloves and you put your hands in. There must have been scores, hundreds of positions in this long, continuous glove box. Behind me, there was another oval hatch, and I stepped through it, and 3 feet down, it ended in a brick wall. That's sealed. I'll give you that. That one's sealed. I really wanted to know what was on the other side of that wall, but I wasn't ready quite to take the crowbar to it because I've seen enough horror movies to know that whatever is on the side of that wall might still be breathing. So I ran upstairs, kind of pushed the hasp back into the wall where it looked like it hadn't been disturbed. And I went to find old Dwight, my boss. He was sitting in his chair, smoking on his imaginary cigarette, because this is a government facility, you're not allowed to smoke, but Dwight just couldn't get away. He would sit there and just pretend to be smoking all day long. I went up and I sat down and he was looking lost in thought. I said, "Say, Dwight, I was talking to one of the older guys down at the loading dock, and he told me that somewhere on this facility there's an underground lab of some sort with glove boxes in it. Do you know anything about that?" And he took a puff of his imaginary cigarette and he said, "You've been poking around places I told you not to, haven't you?" I said, "Dwight, how could you? He said, "Sit down and shut up." So I sat down and shut up. And he told me that at one time, back around the Vietnam War, there was an active program to develop a super strain of malaria. They were going to infect mosquitoes with this super strain of malaria. They would go through their whole life cycle in this long set of glove boxes. At that far end, which I couldn't see in the distance, there was an elevator which took them upstairs again. And Dwight actually took me there and showed me the ordnance loading room. They would have these mosquitoes go up into what looked like a big metal torpedo with a square opening in the side and a little workbench in it. And Dwight explained to me that they would put a technician in there, and then they would weld a patch onto that opening and seal him inside, and then he would transfer the mosquitoes into their little ordnance, if you will. And then when they were done, they would take a cutting torch and they would cut him out. I said, "Well, that seems a little roundabout there. Why didn't they just put a door in?" And Dwight said, "Well, that was for safety. If something went wrong and one of the mosquitoes got out, they just wouldn't open it. Remember, we're the good guys. Don't ever forget that." I have been doing this, as I said, for, oh boy, I don't know, almost 30 years now, this whole storytelling thing. And it has taken me around the world. They've had me do this in Australia. They've had me do this in Germany. They've had me do it in France. They've had me do it in Japan. They didn't understand a word of it, but they loved it, I assure you. And you're in Pittsburgh, in Magnificent Pizza Parma. And hopefully very, very soon I'll be able to get my lasagna wrap. I'm looking forward to that. I have been able to pick up a smattering of other languages just by my travels, particularly German. I would not go so far as to say that I speak German, but going to Euroferenz every year, which is in Germany, I have picked up a fair amount. And somebody at a convention a couple of years ago was sitting with me at the bar, surprise, and asked me about my knowledge of German. And I said, "Well, actually, I only have picked up what I need in Germany when I'm at Euroferenz. For example, I know how to say Wein. Yeah. I know how to say Weisswein. I know how to say Geben Sie mir Weisswein. I learned how to say Geben Sie mir Weisswein jetzt. And I learned to say Geben Sie mir Weisswein jetzt, bitch." And he laughed. He thought that was funny. And the lady at the bar came stalking up to me and said, "What did you just say to me?" I'm not often rendered speechless when I'm in storytelling mode. I wound up giving her a $20 tip. Folks who have been watching these stories for many, many years might remember a tale that goes back to probably the earliest, probably the first year of Anthrocon. I was working for a little tiny company in Pennsylvania. By tiny, I mean maybe 20 people total, one of these startups that came about in the late 90s. And the boss came in, very, very brilliant scientist, Anthony Giordano, his name, Tony to his friends. He came in and he said, "Hey, Sam, I need a favor. Your colleague, Gordon, it's his birthday today, and we're going to have a little shindig this afternoon. I ordered a cake, but I don't have time to go get it. I got a bunch of phone calls. If I give you the money, can you go to the bakery and pick it up for me?" I said, "Yeah, sure." Now, I kind of wish I'd been able to bring what I typically wear in the wintertime. I am one of these guys that still remembers the days when men wore hats all the time, and it's something I want to bring back. It's my thing. In the winter, I am often seen wearing either a bowler or a fedora and a black trench coat. It gives the very, very strong appearance of a Philadelphia mafioso. That's not by design, but it's kind of fun sometimes. This was wintertime, and I drove to the bakery, and it had a big picture window in front, and I happened to catch sight of my reflection with that fedora pulled down over my eyes, the black trench coat, and I got a notion. Now, something that many people are not aware of is that I was actually born with a birth defect. Most people are born with a little angel on this shoulder and a little devil on this shoulder. I was born with two devils, and they usually say the same thing. So I got an idea, I'm gonna have a little bit of fun. Now, you had to picture the fedora here. I went in, kind of shifty-eyed, looking around, and a nice old lady came out and said, "Can I help you?" I said, "Yes, I understand you have a cake for Mr. Tony Giordano. I've been sent to collect it." She said, "Oh, yes, certainly." And she went in the back, and when she came out, her demeanor had changed. She was pale, she was perspiring, she was shaking. I was concerned. I thought, my heavens, is this poor lady having a heart attack? She put the box down with trembling hands and backed up like this. And I was very, very taken aback. And I opened the box. Tony had not explained to me that that particular day was Gordon's 40th birthday. And as a gag, Tony had ordered a cake in the shape of a tombstone with Gordon written across it. Remember the two devils? I said, "Yes, this appears to be the message Mr. Giordano wishes to convey." And I closed. I said, "Now, how much shall I give you for it?" I paid her and went out to the car. It started to snow, so I had to dust off the car a little bit, and put the cake on the passenger seat and started driving. When I got out onto the main road, I glanced in the rearview mirror and saw a local police car was traveling in the same direction behind me. When I made a left turn, he made a left turn as well. I made another left turn and he made another left turn. Then I turned right and he turned right. I came to a stop sign. I very carefully turned left. He kept going straight. I hit the gas and got the hell out of there. To this day, I still don't know. I think they might still be looking for me. Fortunately, I didn't stay in that job terribly long. Like I said, it was a startup. There were all these little companies showing up. One of them that I went to work for, it seemed to have a fortuitous name for a furry. It was called Bear's Den Bio, like Bear's Den. And okay, what more do I need to know? It's a company with a furry name. I'm gonna apply, I'll work there. Well, I applied, they gave me the job. And I showed up for work the first day, and when I went up to the door, I happened to catch sight of the logo of the company. It was a slope, triangular slope, with a bear on it, kind of peering over the abyss at the end of the slope. And that seemed a rather curious thing to me. So when I went in, was introduced to my new coworkers. I said, I'm kind of curious. The logo there, that who designed that? And they said, that was designed by Mary. She's the boss. Her name isn't Mary. I just refer to her as Mary for reasons. And I said, well, okay. Does it have any meaning? And one guy smirked and said, yeah, it's a bear going downhill. And that was the first inclination I had that maybe I wouldn't be staying in that job very long. Well, it became very, very clear that this company was going to be struggling too. One thing that was curious was that it had no money. I don't know where they were getting their investments from, but the company was constantly broke. But they had a really nice laboratory facility in a sort of industrial park. And it was curious that a company with hardly enough money to keep the lights on was able to afford such a nice lab. And then I found out why. The rent in that lab was extremely low because it was located sort of in a little valley, the lowest point in the industrial park. In fact, the lowest point elevation-wise in the entire county. This was the actual lowest elevation of any spot in the county. From the day I started, I was warned repeatedly, both verbally and with signs, that said, when using the bathroom, do not let the toilet run. Okay. I just took that on faith because the company is not rich. Probably the water bill will go up if the toilet runs. So I was very, very careful not to let it run. Mary was not so much careful. My office was at the end of a hallway and my back was to the hallway. And I was sitting one day at my computer and some instinct told me you should turn around. And I did. Now, you ever seen the movie Titanic? You know that scene where there's like water creeping up the hallway relentlessly toward the camera? That's exactly what I saw. And I jumped up and I ran to the edge of it and another employee came out looking stricken and said, Mary, let the toilet run. I said, well, what the hell's going on? It turned out, and this is why the rent was so cheap. Because of that geological anomaly, if the toilet was allowed to run, it set up a siphon effect that caused all of the sewage in the county to then erupt out of the opening. And that's what we were seeing. I said, well, how do we stop it? They said, somebody has to go in there and turn the crank on the toilet. And I said, okay, who gets to do that? And a very, very fast vote was taken. The new guy. Okay, sure. Had my best shoes on too. I'm like, oh God. Anybody want to know what Mary had for breakfast? Oh, you know, to this day, I cannot eat hot and sour soup. I can't. I got in there and turned the crank and this boiling eruption came to an end. And I came out and people applauded, which was very, very nice. And I'm looking at my shoes. I thought, okay, these are trashed. I didn't know what I was going to do. How was I going to go through the rest of the day? And then it suddenly occurred to me, I've been in emergency services since time immemorial. I've got gear in the back of my car. I've got a pair of boots in there that I probably could have gone and put on to, okay. Yeah, hindsight is often 20/20. Oh, Lord of mercy. Hey, team guys, how much time is left on this, by the way?
15 minutes?
I kind of came to the end of my list here. Probably because I skipped over parts that were a little embarrassing to me. Maybe I kind of have no choice but to go back and cover those. I'll take you back to Paris, a circumstance that I was not very proud of. The last thing you want to do when you're in another country is look like a tourist. It just, you know, it happens here too. When you see a tourist, you immediately think that person is an idiot. So I was trying to blend in with the French people. I had a baguette under my arm and a beret and everything. I had taken the train, as I mentioned, back to Montparnasse, and it was a commuter portion of the terminal. Very, very crowded. The way the fare system worked was you had a card, and you would swipe the card when you got onto the train. And when you got off the train, you would swipe the card too. They had this interesting setup. There was a row of turnstiles with big steel doors on the other side of them. And I stood back and I watched to educate myself. And I watched all these nice French people. They'd slide the card, go through the turnstile, take the card again, and push the door open. So insert the card, turnstile, card, door. Okay, even I can get that. Card, turnstile, card, door. Great. So I went through, card, turnstile, card. I tried to turn around, but the turnstile had my legs. I thought, oh shit, they're gonna know. I'm standing there and all these people are streaming by and I didn't know what the hell to do. So fortunately, God bless good old Madame Cusimano from seventh grade. This nice business lady was walking by, head down, looking very, very involved in her own thoughts. And I said, Madame, au secours, je suis coincé, le porte n'ouvre pas, le temps de get no tomate, je vais pleurer. I don't think I need to translate that. She looked at me and she sighed. And she went to my turnstile, she put her card in, kind of nudged the turnstile, took the card, shoved me against the door to open it and continued on her way. And all I could think to do when I stumbled through was, merci, merci, pas touriste, no, 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 no touriste, no, no, Parisien, oui. I also learned a new French word because at one point I had to make a connection and I was getting from one end of the station to the other and a bunch of people on the platform were standing around looking bored and an announcement came on. Attention en guerre, le train est supprimé. Le train est supprimé. I thought, okay, I don't know that one. But you could tell by the looks on other people's faces who looked suddenly very angry and throwing their arms up in the air. Supprimé means canceled. So, I think that one of the only countries I've been in where I haven't felt like a tourist was England. Because as long as you don't open your mouth, you can get away with just about anything. Because British people, it's part of their culture. If somebody in Britain screws up, they trip over something, everybody else pretends not to notice. It's that whole stiff upper lip thing. But I was there for a little gathering called RBW, Red, Blue, White. And it involved a fursuit walk downtown that took us to the Thames River, where we got onto a boat and proceeded to drink ourselves into an absolute stupor. When the boat landed back, there were about 50 drunken fursuiters, and I was walking with them. And it was so fun walking back past all of the pubs, looking at the British people, trying to pretend they weren't seeing what they were seeing. This gang of 6-foot-tall animal people walking by. You could see their eyes kind of shifting over. I couldn't resist having a little bit of fun. We'd walk by, I'd say, nothing to see here. You've had too much. Time to go home. Thank you very much. Nothing to see here. You've had too much. Time to go home. At one point, I glanced over my shoulder and a bunch of people were leaving. Probably shouldn't do that. At one point, I was in Japan for JMOF, the Japan Meeting of Furries. When people ask me, what is your favorite convention? Typically, I say Eurofurrence. You would think Anthrocon, but Anthrocon tends to be a little busy for me. Eurofurrence is an excellent convention, but JMOF has a local sake brewery that makes a specific brew of sake just for the convention. I liked that. And it was presented at a Saturday night sake tasting that I was invited to. A big hotel ballroom with big tables laid out and 80 different kinds of sake. And I just started at one end and started working my way to the other, sweeping like wildfire. People told me the next day, I don't know if I believe it, because no one has been able to produce any video evidence. But then again, the Japanese are an extremely polite people, so they perhaps were just watching out for my feelings. I was told that the evening ended with the security pulling me physically out of the room, with me hooking my fingernails into the door jamb, screaming that I wanted to live there for the rest of my life. That is not to say that that I drink too much. I do not believe I drink too much, because typically I can remember things. And I had always maintained that sake is such a clean and civilized beverage that, number one, you will not get knockout drunk from it, and number two, it won't give you a hangover. I believed that until a little convention called Furum in Malaysia that I attended with Fox Amor. Watch me name drop. They had sake at the bar, and Fox and I sat, and we were enjoying it. They had dozens of different bottles, so we were happily sampling it. And the evening kind of disappeared around 11 p.m. The next thing I knew, I was waking up in my hotel bed. And yes, sake can give you a hangover. The next morning, I met Fox for breakfast, and we were both sitting there quietly, attempting to eat, feeling a little woozy still. And there was a question on both of our minds, and neither one of us really wanted to voice it. I think it was Fox who said first, "Did we pay our bar tab last night?" I said, "I don't know." So we went to the bar, and there was a person there, and we said, "Hi, we were here last night and drinking sake, and we can't remember if we actually paid our tab." And the person went away, came back somewhat stony-faced, and said, "Your tab was paid." Didn't say, you know, "You paid your tab. Your tab was paid." Really not sure how that came about. And I guess I will never know what happened that night, because at dinner that very day, Fox and I wanted to have some more sake, and when the waiter came by, I said, "May I have sake?" He said, "No, no, no sake." I said, "What? You're out?" He said, "No, we don't have." I thought, that's odd. I'm sure that they had at least 20 bottles in there. So he came by a little later. I said, "Excuse me, are you sure you don't have any sake?" He said, "No, no, no sake." I got a little annoyed, so I went to the bar itself, where a lady was standing, and I said, "Do you have sake?" And she said, "Oh, yes." And she got some for me. And we had some sake at dinner. And I thought that perhaps the gentleman's English wasn't good, or maybe my accent was too thick, and he just didn't understand. No, it was explained to me by the convention chairman the next day as I was leaving. That gentleman, the waiter, had been at the bar that night and did not want us to have any more sake. You would think I would know better in this day of everybody having a video camera at their hip. But at this point, I'm getting a high sign telling me an hour is just about up, and they call it Uncle Kage's Story Hour. I'm out of things to say, and good old Barris is making me a lasagna wrap back there, and I'm getting pretty hungry, so thank you once again. Again, I hope that you're enjoying this virtual effort to give you the Anthrocon experience, and hopefully this is the last time we'll have to do it. We look forward to seeing you in person in 2022.